Bien, bonjour tout le monde et merci d'être ici à cette rencontre avec Christopher Priest. Alors, Christopher, bonjour. Alors, Christopher, c'est toujours un plaisir de vous recevoir en France. Avec la France, vous avez une très belle aventure depuis des années, depuis par exemple le Monde Inverti, qui avait été chez nous une véritable révolution, qui avait provoqué un accueil incroyable pour le jeune auteur que vous étiez, à juste titre. Et depuis, c'est une histoire qui se poursuit et qui va se poursuivre encore l'année prochaine, puisque l'année prochaine sera publié chez De Noël votre très beau roman The Adjacent, ainsi qu'un recueil de nouvelles aux éditions Le Bélial. Alors, Christopher, on va parler tranquillement pendant une heure. Alors, vous avez dit un jour dans The Quiet Woman que une biographie c'est avant tout une vie, et pourtant souvent vous dites que un auteur ne doit pas se mettre ou ne peut pas se mettre dans son œuvre, mais qu'il y est tout entier, c'est-à-dire quel est le rapport entre un auteur et son œuvre, entre l'homme et l'écrivain, sachant que par exemple en France on a trop souvent tendance à confondre l'homme et l'œuvre. Par exemple, en France, on est persuadé que Winnie l'ourson a été écrit par un petit ours. Qu'est-ce qui, chez vous, qu'est-ce qui, chez vous, rentre dans vos romans de Christopher Priest?
Hello. First of all, I wish to apologize for not being able to speak French very well, and I hope you can understand me and follow me. Xavier is talking about biography and the presence of the author. It would be a lie to say that there is no author in the novel. But on the other hand, I always think a novel should be a work of the imagination. And therefore, in a sense, it's abstract. It's a construct. It's something artificial made by the author. On the other hand, it would be wrong to say there's nothing of the author in there. And in my case, I'd never consciously written any autobiography in any of my novels, except that every now and then you get a problem where, you know, there's something goes wrong. And I think, what would I do in that position? How would I resolve it? How would I react to that? And that's really the only test I have. I suppose another way of doing it would be to say, how would my friends do it? Or how do I think it could be done? But basically, I would never describe a situation that I have been in.
Je sais pas, il y a un petit problème de traduction. Quelqu'un traduit? Moi, j'ai rien dans mon casque déjà. Alors, vous aimez beaucoup Graham Greene. Vous aimez beaucoup son autobiographie, Une sorte de vie. Et vous en parlez assez régulièrement. Dans son autobiographie, Graham Greene dit combien est importante les premières lectures chez un auteur, et il dit aussi que un auteur, c'est celui qui, le romancier, c'est celui qui doit s'oublier pour écrire. Alors, quelle est chez vous la part de vos premières lectures, et quelle est la part de votre oubli, de votre imagination?
I don't know how well Graham Greene's autobiography is known in France. For me, it's a very important book because it's the only book I've ever read which describes exactly what writers do. And I got a lot of inspiration from it, and I often go back to it and look at it because it's so true. And true books are rare. And he tells a story, for instance, about a time when he was diagnosed with a serious illness, and he had to go into hospital. And in those days, the hospital wards were large rooms with beds all down both sides. And it was a men's ward. And he describes how, while he was in there, a boy was brought in. by his parents, and the boy was put into one of the beds, and the parents stayed for a while, and then the parents left, and then suddenly there was an emergency, and all of a sudden a team of doctors appeared, and the curtains were put around this boy's bed, and the parents were summoned back, and they came in, and all of a sudden the mother started crying, and the father looked really upset. And he describes how one by one, all the men in the ward, all the beds, one by one, they put on the earphones so they could listen to the radio and block this out. And he said, I didn't, I listened. He said, I thought one day this is going to be useful to me. And he came up with this memorable phrase that in the heart of every writer, there is a splinter of ice. And I thought that how true that is, that you go through an ordinary life, you experience things with that everybody else does, but you can never quite turn off that need to know what's going on, to see feelings, to understand things.
Oui, tout à fait. Ce morceau de glace dans le cœur, c'est quelque chose que vous avez aussi repris. Alors, d'un autre côté, vous dites souvent, ça apparaît dans différents entretiens, que vous découvrez votre livre alors que vous l'écrivez, qu'un livre a besoin d'être écrit. C'est quelque chose que vous dites assez souvent. Ça, vous êtes votre lecteur, votre premier lecteur.
Yep. I think it was the poet W.H. Auden who said, how do I know what I think until I see what I've written? And that's very much for me. One of the problems for writing a book for me is actually starting. And I go for day after day, week after week, thinking, I must start work. And I don't start because I don't know how the book is going to go. And then one day I do actually write something. And at that point, it becomes clear. The characters come off the page and the idea becomes coherent. And so really, the thing to do, what writers do, is write. And we should be writing all the time.
Voilà. Et alors, écrire, c'est sont des choix, évidemment. Vous avez, on va en parler, évidemment, un rapport très proche avec l'histoire. Et pourtant, vous dites aussi que quel que soit l'intérêt qu'a l'écrivain pour l'historien, pour l'histoire, il n'est pas un historien et qu'il peut prendre certaines libertés avec l'histoire, l'histoire au grand H, hein, l'histoire des événements, à condition de faire arriver le livre qui devait être écrit. Alors, quel est votre rapport avec l'histoire que vous aimez, on la voit à travers le prestige, la séparation. Comment peut-on jouer avec l'histoire ?
I always forget who said it, but those who ignore the lessons of history are doomed to repeat them. And so, although we write fantastic literature, we set stories in other worlds, we deal with things which haven't happened yet, you cannot avoid what we've known from history. And the older I get, the more I'm aware of that, and how much I enjoy reading about historical events and seeing parallels with not repetitions, but things where people were confronted with the same sort of problems that we're confronted with today, and it suggests a way through it.
Dans votre postface aux extrêmes, The Extremes, vous dites que vous n'écrivez pas des romans à thèse et vous donnez les thèmes qui vous sont chers, qui sont par exemple la mémoire, l'identité, la gémilité, les doubles. Est-ce que ce sont des thèmes que vous vous imposez ou est-ce que ce sont des choses que vous retrouvez presque naturellement, qui reviennent naturellement ?
Oh God. There are subjects which interest me, and they come back because I always feel that I can't deal with them enough. For instance, you mentioned twins. My own children are twins, but my interest in the twin effect came long before I actually had twins, so it was very lucky to have my own twins. Unfortunately, my twins are the wrong sort, that there's a boy and a girl. So they're two very different people. And my real interest is in the identical twin. It goes on. I remember during the Iraq War a few years ago, the news came out that Saddam Hussein had 12 doubles, 12 men who looked like him. And I thought, what a terrible job that would be to look like Saddam Hussein and know that there were 11 more doing your job too.
Surtout aujourd'hui. Alors, toute votre œuvre, c'est aussi une réflexion sur le réel. Et j'avais lu, lors d'un entretien que vous aviez donné à David Kendall pour The Edge, que Kendall disait que votre travail, c'est une sorte de jeu entre le réel et la fiction. Et je n'étais pas très convaincu, moi, de la définition de Kendall, vous non plus d'ailleurs, parce que, en fait, la fiction, c'est le boulot de tout écrivain. Moi, je pense que votre travail, c'est plutôt une réflexion sur le réel et le vrai, ce que l'on tient pour vrai. Souvent, vous montrez qu'il y a plus que ce que l'on croit vrai. Le vrai, c'est une définition qui dépend d'une époque, de gens, etc. Vous jouez davantage sur la notion de réel, qui est beaucoup plus, par exemple, un mensonge, c'est réel. C'est pas vrai, mais c'est réel. Est-ce que c'est pas plutôt, plus que la différence entre le réel et la fiction, une réflexion entre le réel et le vrai, votre travail ?
The first question is, what is real? I'm never sure what's real. I've got a view of the world, which is absolutely practical. I know where I am. I know my name. I know who my friend here is, and I know who you are. And I know what I have for breakfast. And I know a lot of things, but I'm not sure they're real. Am I imagining the whole thing? And what about you? Are you experiencing this differently? I'm sitting here, you're sitting there. We already have a different view of this room through just simply through sitting in different places. Anyone who's worked with criminal evidence, and I have, you find that 10 people who witness the same event will witness it differently. They will actually contradict each other. You hear they say, the man got into a car and drove away. And then somebody else would say, no, somebody else drove him away. And then somebody would say, well, it was a blue car. And somebody else would say, well, it wasn't blue, it was red. And so you suddenly realize that what we perceive cannot be relied on. So there's the question of external reality always interests me, because I'm never sure of it. And so when I'm coming to write fiction, fiction is an extension beyond that. I mean, fiction is unreal. The whole point of fiction should be that it's untrue. And yet, most fiction is real or real-seeming. In English, they say verisimilitude. It seems to be true. And that gives to me, as a writer, an extra edge of tension, something which I can use. You use the word play. I don't think it's playing. It's experimenting, really. It's finding out what is real. And at the end of the day, the only reality that counts is the interior one, the one we perceive. It's good enough.
Justement, je rebondis tout de suite sur ce que vous venez de dire. Nous, en France, on n'a pas la chance d'avoir la distinction entre play et game. Vous l'avez, vous êtes des vénards, les Anglais. Play, c'est plutôt une sorte de jeu libre, et game, peut-être quelque chose de plus cadré, je ne sais pas. On joue beaucoup dans vos romans, d'une manière ou d'une autre, mais c'est quel type de jeu ? C'est play ou game ?
No, it's not. It's neither. It's not. What do you say? Un jeu? It's not the same. I suppose, in a sense, it's the techniques of game that fiction uses. It's the same. You have the same sort of influence over the events. But to me, fiction's very serious. I'm really boring on this. I think fiction is and should be a serious matter, taken seriously by serious readers. But at the same time, those sort of readers should have enjoyment too. It should be a pleasure to read. So it's not a game. It's never a game. It's for me, it's a passion, and it's a lifelong commitment. And I'm sort of really serious about it.
Mais par exemple, dans le prestige, on voit que les deux magiciens sont passionnés. C'est une passion d'une vie à chaque fois. Mais on dirait qu'il y en a un qui prend quand même plus plaisir que l'autre. Il y a un caractère obsessionnel chez l'un et peut-être un côté plus ludique chez l'autre, non ? Qui apparaît beaucoup plus dans le roman d'ailleurs que dans le film. Il y a quand même un qui a la traîne et qui est toujours distancé par l'autre et qui donc perd peut-être ce plaisir, non, du jeu de l'illusion.
At the end of this, I'm doing the introduction to the film of The Prestige, which is showing here at midday. I like the film, but it misses one thing. If you go to a performance of magic, the one thing that you will do is laugh. People always enjoy magic. It's funny that magicians are very amusing to watch. And in the film of The Prestige, they take it very, very seriously. And that element of the magic is missing. And I think it's okay, because the film works on a very sort of deep level. But I remember while I was writing The Prestige, I went to several performances of magic. And what I remember most was the audience laughing. And it's a sort of pleasurable feeling of being baffled. Does that answer your question?
Oui, tout à fait. D'autant que, si je me souviens bien, le prestige, il est lié chez vous à un plaisir d'enfant aussi. C'était un livre que vous aviez, un petit livre de magie que vous aviez enfant, qui énonçait les règles de la magie. Non, donc ça remonte aussi à la joie de l'enfance. Il y a de ça aussi.
I've still got the book. And, the thing about it is that everyone enjoys magic. It's something we all enjoy when we're children. Some magicians put on shows for children. I'm no different from that. I like magic. And then I forgot about it and grew up and life went on and I became a writer. And then one day I was thinking about magic and the way a magician, in a sense, tells a story which deceives the audience. And that's what a fiction writer does. And I suddenly thought, there's a metaphor there. There's something I can use to describe the process of writing a novel through the way a magician constructs a trick. And so I just wrote this as a novel. But since then, I've met several magicians. And they all said, yes, that's exactly right. That's how we do it. We see it as a story. You set something up so that people understand what you're about to do. And then you show them yourself doing it. But at the end, it comes out differently. And I think that's true of all fiction. You think a novel is going to be what the publisher says on the cover it's going to be. But when you read it, you find out it's different, it's better, it's, you know, it has a surprise or two.
Oui, alors justement, cette surprise, ce témoignage, vous avez parlé tout à l'heure de l'importance du témoignage, j'aimerais bien qu'on y revienne, et aussi d'ailleurs au prestige. Ce qui manque aussi au film, et qui était très important, me semble-t-il, dans le livre, c'est les témoignages... écrit, il y a une part qui se passe aujourd'hui dans le roman Le Prestige qui a été gommé du film, je trouve ça dommage. Et dans toute votre œuvre, il y a une importance du témoignage. Le témoignage modifie souvent la réalité, par exemple dans La Fontaine pétrifiante, The Affirmation, dans La Séparation aussi, dans Le Prestige bien sûr. Quelle est l'importance du témoignage pour comprendre la réalité?
We only really know what happens when people tell us what happens. And history is based almost entirely on the written record. The history of the 20th century is different because there's film and there's some television, and there's oral recordings. But up till the beginning of the 20th century, all history was based on the narrative. And the narrative still exists. I mean, historians often say that you can't write about a war or a historical event for many years, not because you can't understand it, but because you don't understand the consequences. There was a book published about 5 years ago in English. I'm afraid I can't remember the name of the author, but it was a history of the American Civil War, which took place in about 1860, around then. And it was reckoned by most historians to be the first book which was historically a true record, because it summed up all the motives behind the war, all the events of the war, all the participants. It was understood. Its historical context was becoming clear at last. And that was nearly 150 years after the end of that war. And the same is true now about the Second World War. We still do not have a definitive history of the war, of the Second World War, partly because it's still going on. And it's very, very important that those records exist. And again, coming back to it, the work of the novelist is very comparable to that. We're writing the history of the future.
Oui, et par exemple, dans La Séparation, je trouve que les deux réels, au moins, il y en a peut-être même trois avec celui qui lit, permettent d'avoir un éclairage de l'histoire par la fiction. Alors, par exemple, quand vous écrivez La Séparation, vous écrivez un roman pour le plaisir d'écrire, ou est-ce que vous voulez quand même glisser quelque chose sur l'Angleterre, la guerre, Churchill, ou est-ce que vous n'êtes pas anglais à ce moment, vous êtes juste écrivain?
I think the always the initial instinct for a novel is to tell a story and to find a way of telling it interestingly and amusingly. I mean, you mentioned The Separation, which is the novel I've written about the Second World War. I have no memory of the Second War. I was born during it, but I don't remember any of it because I was a baby. What I remember is growing up with the consequences of the war. I grew up in that period when France was coming to terms with what has happened here, when the Nazis were here. In Britain, it was to do with the social upheavals that followed the war. It was to do with rebuilding cities and all the damage that was done. The history in Germany, very different there too. So that was a period of change, and it was, for me, as a child growing up, it was a mystery. I couldn't think what had happened to cause so much trouble. And so, in a sense, I'm still finding that out and answering it. Sorry, I've forgotten your question.
Non, c'est intéressant parce que ça rejoint quelque chose que je voulais vous demander. Beaucoup de vos personnages s'adaptent. Il y a, par exemple, dans Notre île sombre, qui est paru chez nous, reparu dernièrement, ou dans La Séparation, dans Le Prestige, vos personnages sont toujours en train de s'adapter, mais c'est peut-être parce que votre réel change, non? Ils sont quasiment obligés de faire face à tous ces changements. Alors, pourquoi tous vos personnages sont toujours en train de s'adapter?
Because if they didn't adapt, you wouldn't have a story. It's as simple as that. It's what I was saying at the beginning. You know, an event occurs, and the characters have to react to it. You call it adapt. But we learn. Everyone learns as you go on, and that's the element of story, that things change, and the story tells you how it changes.
Alors, ma question, en fait, concernait la partie anglaise de La Séparation, mais elle est peut-être bête en fait comme question, mais moi ce qui m'a impressionné, c'est la manière dont Churchill, qui est finalement peu présent dans La Séparation, est très bien campé. Votre Churchill est très crédible, et est-ce qu'il est difficile de s'attaquer à une figure historique quand on est par son identité, par sa nation concernée, c'est ça en fait.
Yeah, Churchill's a real problem. When I was growing up, he was widely regarded as a hero. My parents particularly felt that he had won the war, this kind of thing. As I grew up and started reading and learning, I realized it was much more complex than that, and that the nature of Churchill was fascinating. He was a fascinating man, but he wasn't a hero. And he came up with all sorts of weird things. I've always mentioned this when I come to France. I don't know how many people know it happened, but when the Nazis were invading France in 1940, Churchill flew to Paris and suggested that France become part of Britain, and that it would be ruled from London by him. Daladier, the Prime Minister at the time? He said, no. I don't know why. But there is a novel there, the idea of France being ruled by Churchill. I mean, God knows what that would be like.
Ce serait, oui, on en vient presque à le regretter. Vous dites aussi que Churchill est un très bon auteur. Vous aimez beaucoup son style, sa plume classique.
He's a Nobel laureate, and a lot of people think he was a Nobel laureate for peace. In fact, he was a Nobel laureate for literature. And it was really based on his six-volume history of the Second World War, which is, I think, unique in literary history, in that it's a history of events written by somebody absolutely at the center. And it's also a great literary work. The style, the sheer compassion and interest of the book, it's really an extraordinary book. Is it known in France?
Oui, c'était publié plusieurs fois en plusieurs volumes. Moi, je les ai, par exemple. Oui, c'est vrai qu'il écrivait très, très bien. Justement, en parlant de littérature anglaise classique, j'aimerais bien, surtout aux Utopiales via Verne, qu'on revienne à H.G. Wells. Vous avez toujours dit aimer H.G. Wells. Vous lui avez rendu un hommage qui n'est pas un pastiche, je vous en expliquais très bien, qui est une appropriation de Wells avec The Space Machine. C'est pas une plaisanterie, c'est vraiment un roman wellsien. Et moi, il y a une nouvelle de vous que j'adore, que je trouve peut-être plus wellsienne que The Space Machine. C'est, alors mon anglais est horrible, mais c'est Pally Loitering, c'est chez nous, Égère solitaire et pâle. Je ne sais pas s'il est traducteur. Elisabeth Pally-Loitering, ça se comprend?
Yep.
Bon. Je trouve qu'elle est très wellsienne. Est-ce que vous pourriez nous parler un petit peu de votre rapport qui est constant, en fait, avec H.G. Wells?
Oh, that would take a long time. But those stories, the machine à explorer l'espace, and I don't know what Pally-Loitering is called in French.
La machine égère solitaire et pâle.
Yeah.
C'est magnifique, c'est une très belle nouvelle.
They were both written when I was a young writer. And the interest for me was that I grew up reading H.G. Wells. And I soon noticed there was a difference between the books he wrote. The ones he wrote at the beginning when he was a young man are much better than the ones he wrote as an older man. In fact, he wrote, I think, something like 150 books in his lifetime, and about half of those are novels, and most of them are pretty unreadable. But the ones he wrote when he was a young man, when he was kind of poor and struggling and trying to make his way, they're classics. He wrote something like five or six science fiction novels, which are the work that we remember him for. He's a great writer. And as a young man, I suddenly realized I was the same age then as Wells had been at that time. And so I suppose it was an act of hubris to say, what I want to do is to write a novel as if I was H.G. Wells, go back to that, try and recapture that sort of fun, the enjoyment he had, the love of story. before he became important. He used to go and consult with Stalin and Roosevelt, and he took himself very seriously. He was always lecturing people. That wasn't the Wells I loved. The Wells I loved was the young man full of ideas.
Donc c'est une nouvelle que je conseille vraiment au public qui va être reprise d'ailleurs dans l'anthologie qui va paraître l'année prochaine. Et alors justement, en parlant de nouvelles, vous avez dit que vous n'êtes pas un homme de nouvelles, que ce n'est pas votre distance, la nouvelle, que vous êtes plutôt allé sur la longueur, alors que parlant de votre ami Ballard, vous l'estimez meilleur écrivain dans ses nouvelles que dans ses romans. Alors, qu'est-ce qui fait que vous pensez plutôt auteur de romans et, mettons, Ballard auteur de nouvelles ?
Well, you're right. I think Ballard, as a short story writer, is second to none. I think he's an amazingly good writer. His novels are okay, and they're interesting, and one or two of them, Crash, The Atrocity Exhibition, I think are great novels. But the trouble is, if you've got a writer with a body of work, people tend to concentrate on the novels. And in Ballard's case, it's concentrating on not the best of his work. I'm personally not a good short story writer. I've written a few. I'm never happy doing them. I suppose they're okay in some sense, but I feel more normally, naturally, a novelist. I feel I like the length, I like the space. For that reason, I'm not on Twitter. I can't do everything in short sentences.
Alors, dans vos romans, il est aussi souvent question de liberté, et j'ai trouvé deux fois dans vos entretiens de ces 10 dernières années une réflexion qui est intéressante. Vous distinguez entre être libre et être libéré. Souvent d'ailleurs, quand vous parlez des Américains, vous dites ils sont pas libres, ils sont toujours en train de se libérer. Vos personnages, ils sont libres ou ils se libèrent ?
Yeah, there's two kinds of free. I don't know how this translates, but there's freedom from and freedom to. The Americans are very strong on freedom to. They're free to do what they want. They weren't free to carry guns in particular, but they're free to travel, they're free to meet, and they're free to have beliefs, and they're free to live alternative lifestyles. They're free to do things. It's very strong. It's in their constitution. It's also in the mentality of most Americans you will meet. They feel freedom very strongly. I think the European sensibility on freedom is the opposite. I think we're free from, which means we're not, we have an attitude where we don't want people to interfere with us, so that we are free to live our own lives. And to me, it's a very important distinction. For instance, the Convention on Human Rights, which is intrinsic to European law, is based entirely on the principle of freedom from. There's no mention in there of the right to bear arms, for instance, which the Americans have. But the Americans, in a sense, have the right to shoot you. The Europeans have the right not to be shot.
Il y a le thème des armes à feu qui est secondaire chez vous, mais qui est important dans un ouvrage qui s'appelle Les Extrêmes. Vous aviez consacré un entretien aux extrêmes, concernant les extrêmes, où une bonne part de l'entretien portait justement sur les armes à feu. Dans le roman Les Extrêmes, il est très important que les Anglais n'aient pas d'armes à feu. Est-ce qu'il vous arrive, par exemple, Les Extrêmes aussi, il y a cette tuerie auquel vous avez failli dont vous avez failli être témoin. Est-ce que des fois vous êtes soumis à un thème ? Est-ce qu'il y a un thème qui s'impose à vous ? Vous ne pouvez pas faire autrement qu'écrire, en l'occurrence la tuerie, les armes à feu, les extrêmes.
It's true that Britain is largely a society without guns. The police, for instance, don't carry weapons. They carry whistles, and they carry a club, and they carry a radio. but they have no guns. There are some police who are trained to use guns, but they can only be called out on certain circumstances. And as a general rule, the criminals don't use guns either. So we're a largely gun-free society, but they do exist, and of course we're aware of that. I wrote The Extremes about 20 odd years ago. I was present in a place called Hungerford on the day that one of these gun outrages took place, when a young man got a Kalashnikov rifle and killed, I think, 14 people, and wounded a lot more, and then killed himself. And I was there when it happened. I didn't see it, but it was going on while I was there. And that sort of interested me, because that it could happen in England. And then I, of course, was aware of similar events going on in America, and I wondered what would happen if, this is what the novel's about, what would happen if there were two incidents on the same day? Would the people in Britain hear about the American one, and would the Americans hear about the British one? And then I thought maybe there's an idea in that the event was the same one, and that it was a symptom of something much larger.
Oui, alors dans les extrêmes, il y a une coïncidence de ces tueries. Dans la séparation, il y a une coïncidence de réalité. Dans le prestige, il y a une rivalité qui coïncide entre ces illusionnistes. J'ai l'impression que dans votre travail, c'est pas tant une réflexion sur le futur que sur la multiplicité des présents. Vous aimez jouer beaucoup avec différentes variations du présent. Peut-être un peu moins qu'avec le futur. Par exemple, dans Futur intérieur, c'est un futur qui est rêvé au présent. Est-ce que ce n'est pas le présent, en fait? Vous n'êtes pas un auteur du présent ou des présents?
You can only write about the present. Everything a writer writes about is the world in which he or she lives. There's no avoiding that. You can't pretend you live in outer space or something like that. And this becomes particularly true if you look at fiction from another era. I remember many years ago, I came across a short story. I can't remember who wrote it. But it was about this an invention of a new hat. Chapeau. And this hat had a lever in it. So as you walk down the road and you met a lady of your acquaintance, you press the lever and it raised the hat. And it was very ingenious and very polite. And it was set in the 21st century. Now. And of course, what you realize then, it tells you much more about the period in which the writer was writing, about the whole courtesy and the moral code of that time, than it tells you about today, because people don't do that. You know, it's not that world has gone. So, in a sense, so that future vision was really a metaphor for the world in which that writer was living.
Oui, c'est comme les couvertures des revues scientifiques des années 50 qui décrivaient l'an 2000, où on voyait une ménagère préparer un pain de viande, sauf que son tablier était en aluminium, le facteur était sur un scooter aérien. C'était le futur du passé. Alors justement, en parlant de futur proche, de futur immédiat, vos livres, vous ne les achevez jamais. Bien sûr, il y a une fin. Il y a un terme au livre, mais par exemple dans les extrêmes, dans le prestige et même dans la séparation, pour parler des plus récents traduits, il n'y a pas de fin rassurante qui fait que le lecteur se dit ah bah ça y est, il y a une résolution, j'en ai eu pour mon argent, le bouquin se termine, le mort est dans la bibliothèque, on connaît l'assassin. Vous, c'est pas votre truc, pourquoi?
Thank you. when does anything end? I mean, the conclusion to a story is a conceit. Things don't end. And if you look at the Victorian novel, the last chapter almost always said, well, after these events, these two got married and they had three children, and he got a job, and, you know, who cares? I mean, I always think that the first of all, I would dispute what Xavier says. I think my books do end, but they don't end in plot terms in the sense of winding things up neatly. But I think psychologically they've reached the end, they've reached the conclusion of the situation. And secondly, I think there's a convention in Western literature of completion, that things should be explained and finished. But in my experience of the world, people are much more interested in questions. And I'd like to sort of raise questions in people's mind. And to me, the question is more interesting than the answer. You know, what's the future going to be like? And then somebody says, well, it's all sort of meatloaf and hover vehicles, you know? It's not very interesting. But the question's interesting.
Oui, c'est... Non, vous avez raison, c'est vrai qu'il y a une résolution, par exemple, il y en a une magnifique dans Les Extrêmes qui est très émouvante, où l'héroïne arrive enfin à une sorte de paix intérieure. Ça me fait penser aussi au goût que vous avez pour David Lynch, non? Justement, vous, lors d'un entretien, vous disiez que ce que vous aimez bien dans David Lynch, dans le cinéma de David Lynch, c'est que il n'y a pas d'explication, et que lorsqu'un de vos amis vous dit « Non, non, mais attends, Lost Highway, c'est simple, je vais te l'expliquer », vous n'êtes pas convaincu. C'est quelque chose que vous ressentez aussi dans vos romans? Il y a une parenté avec le cinéma de David Lynch?
Yeah, I think David Lynch is one of the most interesting filmmakers in America. One of his best-known films is, excuse me, Lost Highway. I don't know if it's called in France. It's completely unexplained. It's a mad film. Mulholland Drive is a mad film. You don't know what the hell's going on, but it's highly entertaining on the way, and you never forget it. This is the thing. If you have a very conventional novel, a love story, or you know, a crime story, you will often forget afterwards the resolution. You think, oh, they got, you know, they fell in love and got together, and that's the end. You don't remember anything about them beyond that. And with a filmmaker like Lynch, who I think is asking questions rather than answering them, you get that same memorable feeling. You think, my God, that was interesting. And that to me is, you see, I always maintain, and you'll hear me say it if you come to hear me speak, I'm always going on about the fact that I think the act of reading is as creative as the act of writing. It's very important. Everyone reads a book differently. Because, for instance, when you finish the book, you can't remember the words, you can't remember every word of it. But what you take away from it is the images from the book, which you have created by reading the book. Those images are unique to each reader, quite differently. Nobody will read a book the same way. And so that's why it's creative. And this is why it's much more important to ask questions than to give the answers.
Il y a même un de vos romans où le lecteur a une part de création dans le roman, c'est le glamour. S'il n'est pas attentif à certains moments dans le glamour, s'il répond au téléphone ou s'il va chercher son courrier à certains moments précis du roman, il loupe le roman. C'est un roman qui est remarquablement construit parce qu'il manque un élément au roman qui ne peut être fourni que par le lecteur, par l'attention du lecteur. Alors, cette complicité avec le lecteur, elle est bien sûr commune à tous les écrivains, mais vous, dans la mesure où vous faites travailler le lecteur dans votre narration, c'est inclus. Comment vous la pensez, cette complicité avec le lecteur?
Oh, it's purely commercial.
C'est rassurant, alors.
They may read it again, and with any luck, may buy another copy.
Vous êtes l'héritier d'Agatha Christie et de Roger Ackroyd, alors c'est des romans à lire deux fois pour les apprécier. Eh bien, je crois que, hélas, le temps passe très très vite. On va peut-être garder un petit peu de temps pour les questions. Donc, non, il ne reste que 5 minutes, en fait, pour le film. Donc, 5 minutes pour les questions. 3 minutes. Donc 3 minutes pour les questions. Merci beaucoup, Christopher.
Thank you. Oh, I wanted to say first, before this microphone is turned off, I'd like to say thank you to the translator, who's doing a great job. Thank you.